guys don't actually look like drug addicts. Cover up the tats and you dress a fella properly, and it gives that bloke a chance to be accepted back into society.
How we going?
Good.
It's not my job to change your life. My job is to provide a safe place for you to do what you need to do, correct?
Yes.
I can't hear.
Yes.
I run the strictest rehabilitation centre in the whole of Australia.
I'm going to tell you what you need to hear, not what you want to hear, and if you don't like it, well, get out of my circle. Is that okay?
Yes.
We have a zero tolerance to smoking. If you so much as pick up a cigarette butt, you're instantly kicked off the property.
You've been told 3 times.
We don't allow the fellas to have mobile phones, communication with family.
Agree or disagree?
Agree.
You have to be strict.
Is it okay to tear a person down?
No.
I'm dealing with heroin, speed, benzos, anxiety, depression, alcohol. I'm dealing with liars and manipulators. I'm dealing with these.
Let's see if you're going to be a winner. Random urine test.
It's like my way the highway. Here to change life. Change life or bugger off.
Would you like to tell me what I'm going to talk to you about? Arrogant, aggressive, and causing offence. You agree or disagree?
I've been following, I guess, the rise of Shalom House, the increase in activity of Peter for over a year now. Still controversial in certain parts of the society, but seems to be getting results.
I'm not having none of this bruz stuff. You talk like a man, you act like a man in the house. I'm not having anyone comfortable here. And that language is okay where you come from, it's not okay where you're going. Is that understood?
He's come from being a prisoner and a drug addict himself. If anyone can change the lives of very, very troubled men, it's someone who's been through the bottom of it themselves.
I've done everything you can think of. I've been through it all. Now, if I can change, anyone can change. Look back over my last 26 years of institutions and drugs. Even when I wasn't in prison, I was still in prison. I was trapped. And I hated who I was, I hated what I stood for, I hated the life that I lived. There was 3 or 4 times that I was really, really serious that if someone had to give me a hand at that point, that I would have reached out and I would have changed my life. And so the reason I do what I do is I've found a way out and I want to show them the same way that I've got.
Peter started the program about 5 years ago.
What are we up to, Wayne?
It is a full 24/7 residential rehabilitation centre, so the men come in and they stay in. There's no coming and going.
Our residents will stay upwards of 12 months. They'll live in any one of our 8 rented properties throughout the Swan Valley. Intake fluctuates from 70 men up to 80, depending on who's behaving and who's not.
Shalom means peace, wholeness, fullness. It's everything that is good. And so that's the goal for my fellas. I take 1 out of every 20 to 30 people who come to me. But when I take that person in, I've got to have a look at everything that person's coming with.
I was a good kid. At the age of 7 or 8, my parents divorced. My mum, she ended up getting another bloke. Yeah, things just sort of went downhill.
Jackson's journey started when he was 13. It was a drug mule for, you know, the school that he was in at the time. He had a one night where he went absolutely ballistic. You could tell he was high on drugs because he ruined my house. We've all had to close our doors on him. So Jackson's been living on the street.
The amount of times I tried to fix myself, it didn't work. And one day I was really struggling, not having family for so many years. I really wanted my family back.
And I said, if you want your family back, then you're gonna need to take this step. And the step was to ring Peter.
And when did you get into the powders? When did you go from cannabis?
Within a month or 2 weeks, he'd gone up to the cocaine. And then it took maybe 2 years before I got to the meth.
The pain that the family's been through for Jackson to get to this point, breaking point. You know, this is rock bottom.
Been in a psych ward yet?
In the hospital, yeah. Suicidal.
Oh, yeah. What thoughts were you getting?
walking down the street and just sort of picturing every car go by me and just thinking how easy it is just to sort of turn right and just take one step.
And yeah, one voice says they don't want to die, the other voice says just, man, just stay heavy. And often, sometimes, the only way you feel normal is when you're curled up in a ball, and if you just don't think, it's okay. Yeah, well, let's see what you got. If you've got what it takes.
Let's do it.
With the program, it's broken up into stages, you understand that? So stage one, you come in, we take all responsibility off you. You don't do anything.
And we help our fellows completely restore every area of their life. They restore their finances, they restore their relationships, they pay for the rehabilitation from the beginning to the end, and it doesn't cost the society anything.
So some rules. Agree to comply with the no smoking policy. You do not talk about smoking. Don't mention it, don't bring it up. Agree to have no facial hair. Unkept piercings, unkept hair, your dress sense, you're looking okay. Just got to get that haircut. It's very Justin Bieberish. Can't have that.
When Jackson first came in, he looked like that he was serious. He reminded me of myself when I was his age, wanting to change.
Pete has always been mischievous. Generally, as a boy, just got into trouble, big trouble. And as he got older, it got bigger.
When he was about seven, his dad left, and during that time, his mum was drinking, so she was in and out of rehab. So he would go into foster homes and children's homes, but he didn't want to be there, so he would keep running away.
My mum's life and her drinking was pretty bad, and especially one of the boyfriends she had. I've seen this bloke do a lot of stuff to my mum sexually and physically that's just not okay. Another time, my mate's uncle was molesting me, doing some stuff to me. I just laid there frozen solid and couldn't move. I was had a lot of anger, a lot of bitterness, a lot of resentment, a lot of fear.
Peter ended up in the young people's institutions, not because he'd committed any crime, but they had nowhere else to put him, which was a terrible situation for him.
Longmoor in Bentley is the first stop for the 1,700 children a year committed to the care of the Department for Community Welfare.
I spent my whole childhood from the age of 9 up to 18 locked up. I'd be out for a day, back in for a month, out for a month, back in for 11 months.
For 500 to 600 young offenders, Longmoor is not the last stop. They go into the department's maximum security institutions.
I spent 7 birthdays locked up in Longmoor Riverbank. And when I wasn't locked up, I'd live on the streets. I used to break into houses and steal cars and mug people, and if I wanted something, I just took it.
With the neglect by his parents, the abuse that he had, that he tried to hide it with the drugs.
The first time I tried amphetamines, and I remember the feeling that that gave me, it was just like, it was really incredible, and I really enjoyed it. And for me, that started a life of addiction.
When he got around 18, you started to notice the difference in his personality. Drugs kicked in, it was a shocking thing to watch. Aggression, violence, he just was a different person.
Are you coming in the house, bro?
Sure I am.
Oh, yes!
That's me.
You fella.
Coming into the program, you're coming off a lot of drugs and cigarettes and lustful thoughts and just all these just sort of bad things that are in the outside world. Nice to meet you, Nathan.
Jack, bro.
Nice to meet you,
Jack. Lots of stuff that you like. You guys
have
free reign.
We've got to change what he thinks and speaks and acts and the way he feels about himself and take accountability for his actions.
At the moment, it's summer.
So,
that's why I went for these, because they're nice. A bit overwhelming, but excited. It's going to be a good change. Just knowing that this place is going to be sort of that rock just to hold me and guide me through the path. Hopefully, this is the start of the straight line.
We have a rule, no mullets in the house. And no mohawks and no top knots. So it's really important that we start again from scratch and help our fellows to project an image that people perceive so we can fit in with all circles of people, regardless of what he looks like. Pretty cool, isn't it, Jackson?
It is.
One of the first things we do with our fellows, we get their body clocks established back to normal. Normal people in society work from Monday to Friday, so we actually work here from Monday to Friday, from 9 to 5.
We get house checks every day. It just gets us back into a routine, because where we've come from, we've just pretty much done whatever we wanted, and yeah, we're trying to change.
We're actually a working rehabilitation centre. We start getting them into community service work, picking up rubbish on the side of the road, repairing schools, working for not-for-profit charity groups. Most of the fellas here, except for my work supervisors, have all been in the program for less than 3 months.
I was born into drugs from a young age. First time I probably got stoned was 4 years old. And then around 10 years old, a man stick a needle in my arm.
They're saying the first 2 weeks are the hardest. I'm starting to agree with that. So I'm just keeping going out working. And that's the only way I can do it, is keep working, keep moving forwards.
We're a cold turkey detox. In other words, they don't no medications at all. In any way, shape or form, when they detox, they just sweat and shake and not sleep and are pretty sick. But we still make them go to work. We still make them dig holes and paint poles and pull weeds.
That's what Pete always says. Just go cold turkey and see how long you can go.
There is actual medical supervision.
Yeah.
If the doctor says, OK, because of the environment that you're in, it is a safe place to detox, we're going to support you in that detox.
Like, say I'm sweating a lot, but that's the problem with all this. Okay, you've gone through all this.
Yeah, you have trouble sleeping and feeling sore all the time, tired during the day, isn't it, Nate?
Yep.
I didn't think Nathan was going to last, to be honest. I don't really think any of the new fellas are going to laugh, but he surprised me.
The withdrawal bit's the easy bit. The hard part comes after that, where you've got to start looking into your heart and all the crap starts coming to the surface and you've got to start dealing with everything. That's the bit that puts everyone to the test, eh, Swaney?
Yeah, mate.
I haven't sort of worked in a few years now. It's really good to be back doing this sort of stuff. Feels normal again.
Got to be productive.
Peter has that personality that attracts people. When I met him, he was 19 and I was 17. My friend kind of knew him and she was like, oh, don't go near him, you know, he's bad news kind of thing. But he had a lot of charisma and, yeah, kind of I was attracted to him. I'm from the country, so my upbringing was quite different from Peter's.
She was a geek, you know, a farmer's daughter, head girl at school, ducks, didn't swear, didn't smoke.
So we started seeing each other. I guess as time went on, he started introducing me to drugs. Then we were married in 94. We had our first son in 95. I mean, even though we're on drugs, the kids are still going to school, daycare. I mean, we're still trying to keep life as normal as possible.
My childhood was good. Adventurous, different, open to a lot of things most kids probably wouldn't see.
I just got more into drugs and I thought I might as well start selling drugs for a living. And so, like everything I do, I give it 100%. And within 3 months, I was selling on average of 2.5 kilos of methamphetamines a day, heaps of guns, explosives. I'd done 9mm, 44s, Glocks, pencil guns, you name it, I had it, even subbies and some other stuff. And I went really, really, really big, really, really quick.
I remember always being lots and lots of money, guns and suitcases, lots of police just coming and running after him and tackling him to the ground and stuff.
We used to get raided a fair bit. I remember one occasion that we got up one morning and the helicopter was coming over the roof. The TRG come through front and back with shotguns, bulletproof vest.
That's when I spent a night in lockup, and then the charges came through and Peter ended up going to jail for a year. People would say, oh, why didn't you leave? Or, I mean, I was actually using as well. So for me, that was normal.
I've dragged my wife through a world of evil that she didn't belong in. But yeah, she just stayed by my side through it all.
if he hadn't have got his life sorted out, I dread to think where he would have ended up, because, you know, he got a drug habit, I think about $7,000 a week. And he was paranoid, terrible nightmares and things. He was in a mess.
I started hearing voices in my head, and I wasn't leaping out, even though I used to leap out. I was a pretty good leaper. But I started hearing voices in my head, and this voice kept saying, "Peter, I want you to follow me, I want you to follow me." And I pushed the voice aside and said, "Peter, I want you to follow me." I'm telling my woman, "Amanda, something weird's going down." And she said, "Oh, you're just leaping out of the gear." And I had a dream. And in my dream, God said to me, he says, "Peter, Peter, you're going to tell people. You're going to tell people how I've changed your life."
He woke up one morning and said we needed to go to church. And again, I was thinking this was just psychosis. I went along with it and everything. And just the change in him, just begging me for forgiveness, just completely turning his back to the drugs, to the people that he was around. I was thinking, this is really weird. 2 years later, we were buying our own house, and then we had a gardening and landscaping business. And our kids healthy and going to the same school, and yeah, it was amazing.
I felt that God was telling me to go to Bible college, and I went and done 3 years full-time study. I became a volunteer at Acacia Prison, 3 days a week as a chaplain for just on 5 years. I used to get a lot of men coming along across my path and needing help and changing their life. And so I bought this house in 2012. And then I stuck three or four of these fellas in my house that needed help.
It grew from there, like people, they would know someone. It was all word of mouth.
Matt, nice to meet you.
Shalom started by accident. I didn't mean to start a rehabilitation centre. All I wanted to do was disciple men to be men.
I started smoking meth at 22 as a result of after being in the Bali bombing. I got post-traumatic stress disorder. I've seen a lot of death and destruction in the Sari Club. Yeah, I was just at the bottom of the bottom, and there was no way I was going to get my kids back until I pulled my finger out and, yeah, did something about it.
You know, they really actually want change in their life, but just found it impossible to get there.
Yeah, so I've been here 4 months, but I'm still in stage one because I got kicked out by Peter for using my house leader's phone. He left it on his bed and I text messaged my children, and that's really against the rules, so I got kicked out for that and had to spend the night out in the cold.
16 years of drug addiction was literally lifted off me in a day.
So I've been a good boy ever since then, and yeah, pulled my head in.
I've had a problem with alcohol for about the last 14 years. I've been to rehab 17 times. It just wasn't working. It was just too short a time. I was getting totally desperate. I've put this down as sort of my last chance. I really, 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 really want to get clean. And this is, I think, the place to do it.
I'm starting to fully figure out where everything happened, where I went wrong. My life started changing.
As far as drugs, you can tell that Nathan's been doing it for a long period of time by his health, by his teeth, by the way that he looks. He's just a career drug addict.
One thing I'm doing is mopping. You wouldn't really catch me dead in my old life doing this.
I've done a lot of drug dealing. I regret doing that because I sold to kids around my own age, and stuff I did wasn't right, but I just did it to survive.
He was right on the border of do we or don't we? Are we wasting our time? Are we not wasting our time? Well, I'm really excited that he's actually proved me wrong, and that he's giving 200% and his life is changing, and he's just a really quality, beautiful fellow with an awesome personality.
I'll catch you in the morning, bro. Good night, bro.
Thank you.
as the program goes on and they go from stage one to stage two to stage three, they get given bit by bit more responsibility.
So I'm stage three in the program. Yeah, I'm allowed to get a phone back and things like that. So you pretty much got about 75% of your life back.
We take no government funding. The men that come in our program, they pay $300 per week, and majority of the time that'll come out of their Centrelink payments.
At the 3 month stage, we position our fellas to start work again. And they should be in full-time paid work off of all Centrelink benefits within 8 to 9 months of our program.
We're gonna be having swimming, barbecue, soccer game. Just gonna have a good chill out day, all right?
Yeah. And we really run on the smell of an oily rag. I have to actually pay 22 staff who work next to nothing. Plus I've also got to feed 70 men, transport 70 men. We do have an external auditor. We welcome any person from any place, from anywhere, to freely go over all our books, all our accounts, all our staff. We've got nothing to hide. There's no flies can land on me.
Peter is full-time voluntary, so he doesn't receive any income at all from Shalom. So, yeah, I've been running a gardening and landscaping business, paying all of our mortgage and everything.
Somebody has a 15-minute amnesty. There was two full cigarette butts over the other side. If you so much as pick up one cigarette, you are out of here. If you see somebody else pick it up, you are also gone. Are you really dumb enough to make that decision to ruin the progress that you've made? Now, please go back and finish your game. Is that understood?
Yes. Yeah, well done. Push you on!
I need to be supportive of what he's doing. Yeah, and even though it takes up a lot of our time, I think about if it wasn't for God, if it wasn't for Shalom, if it wasn't for where we were now, I wouldn't have him anyway.
Holy Spirit, we ask in the precious name of Jesus that your presence be felt in this place today.
Some people, when they come in, sometimes it's quite difficult, the Christian side of things.
We have Bible study every morning, which goes on for an hour, and we go to church 4 times a week.
I pray, Lord God, that you'd help this man to lead his home as a man should.
It's been a struggle, I won't lie to you. The faith-based model that they use here is foreign to me.
How did the weekend go, going to the different services? How was that for you?
I'm trying to build a belief. I'm trying. I really am.
Yeah. You're either going to believe or you're not going to believe.
Okay.
You don't need to try.
All right. I've always been a man of science. To be literally ripped out of the real world and placed into a totally different environment, and suddenly have faith pushed at you from every angle has been very, very challenging for me.
And no one can force anyone to believe anything. If you don't want to believe in God, that's okay.
Yep. Thanks, Dad. Thanks.
But we are a faith-based rehabilitation centre. We're unashamedly a Christian rehab. And if you don't know what to present, you don't have to be here. You're free to leave at any time you want to.
I know we are very strict and very tight. I wouldn't say that we're punitive, but that's his call. People do come and go quite a bit. So we might take 5 fellas in. Out of those 5, we might keep 3, and two might leave. But if they complete the program, generally speaking, we would have over 80% success rate at the moment.
Peak made me realise how much of a bad person I'd been. I was just blinded by the drug. You know, I destroyed my whole family, which is a shame. I apologise to them, but they won't talk to me at the moment, so hopefully I get the chance one day to do that.
6 weeks has gone very quick. It's been a very hard journey. There's a lot of just different things that I've been able to deal with within myself, anger issues, and just the way that I sort of just dealt with everyday life.
Well, I've spoken to my dad. What hasn't really happened in a while. We're sitting there talking. I'm actually talking about work, and I'm loving it. Since I've been here, I've changed a lot. I've actually turned my life whole completely around, so it's good. very good, and I'm loving it.
What I get out of it when I see a son hug his father, when I see families come together, that's what I get out of it. I see families restored, I see children from the next generation not having to go through what I went through.
This place has actually given me a way to settle back into society and get back the things that really do mean most to me. This is my son Hudson. He's, how old are you?
Four.
Four, and he's going into pre-primary this year. I went to his school concert at the end of last year, which is something I never thought I'd do just because of the life I was living. And nothing else could help me change, you know, so I really am blessed to be here. So we can hang out, eh, mate?
This is my son, Pete. He's 21, and he works for Amanda full-time, and I love my son. I'm proud of my son. My son is gorgeous. He makes my heart flutter, and I make him feel really awkward. I look at my sons, and my sons are geeks. They're normal people. They're not living the life that I've lived, and they didn't turn out how I turned out. And that's what I get out of it, just to be normal. I used to be really bad, but I've changed. I'm getting better.
He used to throw a washing machine through the back door if he couldn't fix it and stuff like that.
It's gone from a crazy life to still a crazy life, but just honest and loyal. I didn't think you'd ever really be 100% clean and for this long, maintain. Very surprised, yeah. It's not often you hear people doing such big changes.
I'm trying my best. As long as there's blood in my veins and there's air in my lungs, I'm trying my best.
Tell someone to love me. I need to rest in arms. Keep me safe from harm. From pouring rain. Give me endless summer. Lord, I feel the cold. Feel I'm getting old before my time. As my soul heals the shame, I will grow through this pain. Lord, I'm doing all I can to be a better man.